Hello everyone, my name is Sangmin Shim and I'm from Korea. And today, I'm going to talk about high performance web game development for mobile devices. Before we get started, let me briefly introduce myself. I'm a JavaScript developer at NHN Korea. There have been many discussions about JavaScript in Korea. Today, I'm here to share one of the topics with you. But as you can tell by now, my English is not very good. In fact, this is my very first presentation in English. So please bear with me. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Nervous. Okay. Please bear with me, and I'll try to make this presentation as informative and helpful as I can. I hope you all enjoy it. Now, let's take a look at a demo first here. Using your smartphones or other mobile devices, please open this web page. Okay. Please be aware that the URL is case sensitive. Is everyone on this page? Page? You can see? Okay. This is a chess game without turns, meaning you do not need to wait for your opponent to make a move. Let me demonstrate. Okay. Here we go. Oh, okay. Who is Ha Ha So? Ha Ha So? Okay. Oh, this guy. Retry. I only try. I have many time, it's okay. Go. This is a long. Oh, okay. You can just drag and drop your pieces like this. In a single turn. Okay. Okay. Oh, sure. Oh. Oh, yeah. Okay, and capture the king and win the game. This demo was written with an animation library called Colli, which I'll be talking about later in this presentation. Some of you may have devices that I have not tested on, but it should work okay with most of the devices. Anyways, now let's take a look at the difficulties of writing this kind of a mobile game. You can easily build games that run on desktops. But it's not so easy for mobile. There are many operating systems and various devices. Especially for Android, the fragmentation is horrendous. It takes a lot of time to deal with all these devices. That is a picture of the test devices used for Colli. Okay. Not to mention, mobile devices are slower than desktops. And what makes it even worse is the sound support. You can use the audio tag in HTML5. But in mobile, you cannot play two different sounds at the same time. So you cannot have a background music and sound effects simultaneously. As for iOS, you cannot play your sound without a user input. There's a way around this, but when you do play your sound, it will affect the performance of the game. Because of these reasons, some say that two worst enemies in mobile game development are the performance and sound. Oh, yeah, okay. Color. Well, personally, I think it's the Android, but anyways. The mobile environment is evolving very rapidly. Starting from iOS 6, you can play a clear sound using Web Audio API, and you can also play multiple sounds simultaneously. Something similar happened with the performance as well. Canvas became a lot faster in iOS 6. When I tested with the sample animation, I observed that it now runs about 353% faster compared to iOS 4 and 68% compared to iOS 4. No, iOS 5, okay. Reading your own mobile game is not too hard. It's just a little more difficult. I hope after this presentation, you'll have the knowledge to start building your own mobile games. Okay, let's start. First, both Canvas and CSS3 3D transforms have to be supported. To enhance the performance of a mobile game, you need a hardware acceleration. Please take a look at this clip. This is the iPhone 4 with iOS 5 using Canvas. You can see 100 rabbits walking quickly. Starting from iOS 5, hardware acceleration is available when using Canvas. So you can see this smooth animation. And now, this is the same iPhone 4 and same animation, but this time with iOS 4. On your left is iOS 4, and on your right is iOS 5. You can tell the difference, right? iOS is before iOS 5. Okay. Did not have a hardware acceleration support. But as you can see, hardware acceleration is a very important factor in mobile game development. Fortunately, there's a way to get hardware acceleration in iOS 4. That is to use CSS 3D transforms. Now, take a look at this demo. Ooh. Okay. Just like before, on the left is iOS 4, and on the right is iOS 4, i5. But this time, CSS3 3D transforms is used for iOS 4. It's not as fast as the iOS 5 with Canvas, but still a lot faster than before, right? So just like this, to make your animations run smoothly across the platforms, you have to write different source codes depending on the platform. If we are thinking, oh, iOS 4 is such an old platform, maybe my game does not need to support it. Well, then, you should take a look at Android devices. For Android, it does not matter what versions you have. There's just no hardware acceleration support for Canvas. Android 3 or higher support hardware acceleration in CSS3D Transform. But for any versions below, there is simply no hardware acceleration at all. So now, you just have to have two different rendering logics. One is using DOM, and the other is using Canvas. Now, you may be thinking, well, most mobile devices support CSS3D Transforms, so I just ditch Canvas totally and go with DOM. If you are, take a look at the next slide. iOS with the hardware accelerated canvas is just way faster when you are dealing with many objects. So you cannot just settle with CSS3 transforms. You must write twice as many calls until all mobile devices provide hardware acceleration. But nobody wants to write as many calls. So we have to find a way to minimize the need for writing more calls. Find a way so that we can write one code and all these differences will be taken care of automatically. Second, we need to find out the exact extent of an object. When I develop games, I personally feel that finding out the exact extent of an object on the screen was the hardest part. On your left, the picture shows a typical DOM object in a rectangular area. But in a game, you do not want it to occupy this entire rectangle. You'd want to exclude this area where it seems to be blank, just like this picture on your right. Fortunately, in Canvas, you can accurately find the areas using the getImageData method. Using this method, you can check if a certain point on the screen has a pixel with color. But this method has a few drawbacks. One of them is a security limitation. You cannot fetch your pixel from Canvas if the Canvas has any image from a foreign web domain. This security limitation is so strictly enforced that there's just no way around it. Well, if you wanted to so badly, you could have a look at cross-origin resource sharing, but even that only works with Firefox. And it's quite common to make use of CDNs to deliver images, but even this will conflict with the same origin policy, which will disallow getting a pixel from the canvas. What you can do under this situation is to predefine the exact extent of an object. When a user touches the screen, we could use the predefinition to see if there is an object where the user just touched it. Because it's just the definition of an area, you can use the same method for DOM as well. And this method is actually faster than using getImageData method. This method uses PM poly, which is a well-known algorithm being used to check if a given point is located a polygon inside a polygon or not. It's the best solution I have found, but there is a slight problem. Someone has to manually define the area, so who's going to do this cumbersome work? Well, the graphic designers. I feel so lucky that is not my job. Okay. You just need to give the designers the right tools to make the job easier. Third, use your bitmap image instead of a drawing. Drawing vectors is actually pretty slow. Take a look at this demo. On your left, it draws a circle in every tick, and on your right, it just uses an image of a circle. You can see that the right is much faster. So you have to find ways to use less vector drawings. How can you do that? Make use of a cache. Draw a vector image on canvas. This is not part of the body element, which is invisible. And when you need the image, copy the image to the visible canvas. You can see with this method for static or near static images, such as text fonts, to improve the performance. When you rotate an image, it's sometimes better to use a sprite image rather than actually rotating the image. In Android, there's a bug in the rotation function. So you cannot have any hardware acceleration support, which means the difference would be even more dramatic in Android. Graphic effects like shadow or filter is quite expensive. So try to avoid using it as much as possible. Take a look at this demo. We'll often be asked to have a shadow effect. When this happens, just create images with the shadows in advance. Using the pre-created images, the demo looks like this. Yeah, more work for the graphic designers. First, do not use too many canvases. To effectively use canvas, developers often use layers. This method is definitely effective. But you have to avoid using too many layers. This graph shows the performance of 100 objects in which 50 of them are moving. Try to keep these stationary objects in a single canvas to improve performance. Let's say we divide the canvas into 10, then 5 of them with the stationary objects will not do anything, and the other 5 will do all the work. From this graph, you can tell that up to 2 canvases, the performance improves. But if you go beyond that, the performance actually worsens. So more is necessarily better. When I develop a game, I usually use 3 layers. One for the background, and one for the UI, and the last one for everything else. If you have been using just 1 canvas, try to have a few layers, but not too many. Fifth, Android. You should avoid using large images as much as possible. For Android 4.0.1 and below, if you use an image with one side larger than 2048 pixels, the image is going to look black. Yeah, that's your Android. Large images are frequently used for sprites. If you place images in this manner, as you see from this top image, you can very easily exceed the size limit. So place the images like the bottom. There are even more bugs in Android. When you use CSS 3D transforms, you'll be using Rotate 3D. And when you do, the size of the area hidden using overflow will grow larger. So if you use Rotate 3D in Android, you'll notice neighboring sprite images suddenly appearing. Let me show you this. What you see here is the neighboring sprite image. It's because the area grew larger, like this. Unfortunately, the only way around this problem is to use 2D transform. If you want to animate an element using CSS 3D transform, you have to declare the element as 3D. You'd think if you set the transform style to preserve 3D, then all the child elements would be rendered as 3D. Well, not in Android. On your left, only the parent element was declared as 3D and had a preserved 3D attribute. On your right, child elements were also declared as 3D. I'll show you a demo to see what happens when you apply translate 3D attribute to the parent. Have a look. can tell the difference, right? In Android, if you do not declare the child elements as 3D, then you are not going to have hardware acceleration. Let me show you another funny bug in Android. When you develop a game, sometimes you have to use HTML form elements like an input tag. In Android, when using CSS3, it transforms to an image, and if the user touches the input tag, the image will become larger. Let me show you this in this demo. Touch and larger. Refresh. Touch, larger. Oh, that's your Android. Six more technical points. Now, let's talk about something more technical. When you develop a game, you'd want to group the objects as parents and children. Sometimes, one object has a multiple number of child objects, such as the tile map in the background. When you move the map on a canvas, you'd have to redraw a lot of objects. But if you think of it, the map moves, not changes. So you do not need to redraw the entire map. Instead, you can make use of a technique called tile caching. Tile caching is just like object caching that I mentioned earlier. A group of child objects would like one big object. You just need to redraw when a child object actually changes. This method is quite effective. Have a look at this demo. On your left shows what happens if you do not use tile caching. And on your right, you see how much it improves if you do use tile caching. Okay. It runs much smoother, right? And when you redraw something on canvas, do not redraw the entire canvas. Redraw only where there are changes. This technique is called dirty rectangle. Take a look at this demo. Okay. This demo shows dirty rectangle technique in action. Left redraws the entire canvas, and right only redraws where there are changes. But this method has its own limitations. If there are many objects, you are going to have a lot of areas where you have to check for changes. So it's good to split the canvas into smaller tiles and check each tile for changes. By doing this, the number of areas you need to check decreases to the number of tiles. If you have some logics in a tick, you will have to be really careful when checking the performance. A tick usually happens 6 times per second, and they amount to 3600 times a minute. Think about the logic that takes about 0.1 seconds to execute 3600 times. Experienced developers should know what this means. So now, you think there are just too many things to consider? There is a library that has been trying so hard to solve the problem I mentioned in this presentation. It's my real purpose. The library is Collie. The name was taken from Border Collie. Border Collie is a really smart dog breed, good at playing games like Frisbee.
So I felt it goes really well with the library. The logo looks like the dog, right? Okay. Oh, I made. Okay. Yeah. Someday it looks like Adobe's. Sadly, I cannot disagree. Anyways, okay. Corelli, in short, is a JavaScript animation library optimized for mobile devices which supports both HTML5 canvas and the CSS3. Corelli is being tested on over 18 different OSs and devices. And it's designed to automatically choose the fastest rendering method for each of these devices. You can check out the performance data from our website. There are lots of things you can do with Corelli. Take a look at this demo. Okay. You can create an animation that feels like Flash. And okay, apply fishes using Bust2D. Oh, performance is very good. Okay. You can do that. Sounds crazy. Okay. You can also make event pages more interesting on mobile. Users will pay more attention to the pages through this interactive experience. On the left, you see dice being thrown by shaking the mobile device. On the right, you can drag it around the cloud to water the tree. Of course, you can write games too. You can build Windows 8 store apps using Corelli. I'll show you two apps developed using Corelli. This is not Mac. This is Windows 8. Okay. This is the chess game you saw earlier in this presentation. Okay. Left Edge Windows 8 store app. Okay. Oh. Capture the king. Okay, I win. Okay. Thank you. And this is another interesting game developed by an amateur developer.
시작.
If you hold the mouse button, the rabbit goes up. It's interesting. What? Okay. Corelli is about 20 kilobytes zipped and has no dependencies. And Corelli is provided as an open source. You can check out everything about Corelli from here. Okay. And I'm sorry, but because my English is so poor, I cannot take any questions. But fortunately, I'm pretty good with Google Translator. So if you post your questions on the forum or on Twitter, I try my best to answer. Thank you.